And now, it's time for another Dice Tower Review with Tom Vassell.
Hey folks, today we're taking a look at a game called Old World and Code of Nine International Edition. Now this game is made from Japan, it's being reprinted by Z-Man, it's made by the same crew that made Tragedy Looper, which got a lot of buzz, and a lot of people who played it told me that they really enjoyed this deduction-style game. I love deduction, so I was very anxious. Deduction and worker placement, that takes place less than an hour, sometimes 40 minutes. Secret goals? Woohoo! Let's see. The goal of this game is to get the most points. Now, the way you're going to get points is done in a variety of ways. There are a few things on the board that are worth points. These tokens are worth a point. That's worth two. These are worth three. These books are worth one. Coins are worth zero. However, each person is going to have two cards that they're going to have, and you're going to know what these two cards are. They're going to be scoring cards for the end of the game. You're going to have one in the shoal and one in the abyss. The only difference between those is during the game, other players can look at your card in the shoal. You can look at someone's card in the abyss, but it's much more difficult. There's only a few things, ways to do that. But these cards will all be revealed at the end of the game. They will then be combined with this, what looks to be extremely complicated scoring sheet, but it's just so that each card is a code and it shows you when they score, because some cards can cancel other cards out. Some cards are pretty simple, like this one here. All coins get plus one victory point. So you can collect coins when you have this guy, and they're worth more. Here, both players who release the legacies gain 10 points each. There's two legacies down here. They're worth 3 points normally. If you, quote-unquote, release them, then you get an extra 10 points. All players with at least one will, everyone has a will tracker, you'll be spending will to do a lot of the actions, lose 3 victory points. However, if card 16 is in play, then this card doesn't count. Here, your victory points are multiplied by the number of books you have. So there's books here. That will, if you have two of those, all your points are multiplied by that. However, this card's invalid if card 27's in play. Here are the statues. Players with exactly one statue get 3 victory points. So one of these is worth 1, 2 is worth 2, but 1 is worth 4 now when this card is in play. So there's all sorts of different things. There might be one here. If there's a player with the least coins, he's out of the game. All players with more than 5 more items, and the player with the least number of items, they're out of the game. So there's some cards that can throw you out of the game. There's other cards that cancel different cards. All victory points from statues are now negative. So you don't know what's going to be in the game, except you know two of them. Each player then has 3 workers, for lack of a better term. And each round of the game, you're going to be able to place those, starting with the first player and going around the table, and place those on a spot and do that. There's also a card here. The card is just there because you can flip it over depending on how many players are in the game. In round 1, you can only place up here. In round 2, you can now have a few more spots, and some of the spots in round 1 are no longer eligible. In round 3, we add more. In round 4, and in round 5, we add more spots and a few more cards. Most of the spots are pretty general. You can like go here to get a book. But you have to pay a will to do so. Here you get 2 coins. Here you get a will and a coin. Here you get a statue. Here you can steal from other people. Here you can look at somebody else's shoal card. And as it goes down, the things will change. And only one person can be each spot. But you'll see that they start costing more will, too. So getting will, which is in these 3 spots up here, is very important to do. You're going to go through 5 rounds of this, where players will take turns going around. There's even a possibility of there being a card down here that you can switch with one of your scoring cards if you want to. And you can watch what other players are doing, trying to figure out what they are going to be scoring as, or you can just look at their cards. That's something that you can do also. And then after round 5, you will then reveal all the cards. Again, pull out this ridiculously looking score sheet, figure out everyone's scores, and whoever has most points is the winner. I should also mention that the game comes with this sheet here, which shows you what all the cards do. You can play with just the normal cards if you want a somewhat simpler game, or you can play with the expert cards. A lot of the ones that put people out of the game are in this section. These are more basic, like all coins are 1 point, all coins are -1 point, and so on and so forth. And this you can look at trying to figure out what people have by what they're doing. And that's how you play. most points is the winner. Or in the case of an odd circumstance, if you're the only person left in the game, you're the winner. Well, I'm not going to call this game deduction. It's not really deduction. I guess there's a small bit of deduction as you're trying to figure out what other people's goals are based on what they're doing, but that's more bluffing to me than it is deduction. It's a worker placement game with secret goals. You know 1/4 of those goals in a 4-player game, 1/3, well, actually, even in a 3-player game, you only know 1/4 of them. You have a dummy player with cards that you can look at that dummy player's cards. So there's always going to be a pile of cards in the game. Some cards cancel each other out. I might have the +1 for all coins, yay, and then Joe has the -1 for all coins, and so that just cancels out. But you really got to spend some of your actions looking at other people's cards because you don't really know what you're doing otherwise. And the game, it's interesting, but the graphic design is pretty bad. The graphic design on the player boards, I like that. It has this kind of, this is a blackboard and the ink is kind of a shiny metallic style ink. This is nice. The board itself, when I was showing it to you, you might have gone a little cross-eyed. It's really hard to figure out what any of these do. Really bad iconography, just wasn't a fan of that. The art's okay, although it doesn't really have anything to do with the game. And the components are a little chintzy here. But it's a worker placement game. You're just putting out some workers each turn, and there's not that many spots. It's not like a lot of decisions like, ooh, do I want 3-will or 2-will? I think I'll go with 3-will, Bob. You know, there's gold. You can eventually start stealing stuff from other players. But it feels kind of random. And it's not really random, but it feels off random. And sometimes it is because you don't know what the goals are. You're taking a lot of gold. I guess I'll take some of your gold. It seems like that's important. And you could be playing a whole double blind thing like, ha, ha, most gold is out of the game. So I'm going to collect gold and hope other people follow my lead. And that's possible, but you only have so many actions that people, it's best just to make sure the goals you have are taken care of, then try to do maybe some of the other ones that you've seen. I wasn't really that impressed with the game. It has some cool ideas, but in execution, just fell a little flat for me. Just felt like, not really that impressive. It was okay. And the theme wasn't there at all. And just placing workers, I like worker placement games, but and I like the hidden goals, and it's kind of neat that you had some that no one else knew, but I don't know. Each time I played, when I was done, I was like, oh, it felt like, oh, that's the score I got. Huh. How could I play differently to get a different score? Well, I didn't know half of what was going on, so not much. So, not really recommending this one. I think some people will enjoy it quite a bit, but it was too chaotic for a game that seemed like it should be more strategic. Dice Tower Judgment, missed the mark.
Thanks so much for watching the Dice Tower videos. Find more great videos and reviews, as well as our top-rated audio podcast at Dicetower.com. You can also find other great shows at Dicetowernetwork.com. I'm Eric Summerer, and you've been watching the Dice Tower. The Dice Tower is sponsored by Cool Stuff, Inc., where you can find great games for great prices. Cool stuff in stock. Check them out at CoolStuffInc.com.
Shut the door!